Good evening. We continuing our series, The Way of the Righteous, or Chot Tzadikim. Last week was an amazing lecture for over 2 hours, but for whatever reason, the camera did not record it. There was no audio. If you remember, I was in the middle of happiness, simcha. The one week before, I finished half of it, and last week I spoke a lot about this topic of happiness, what's real happiness is. Obviously, I don't have the ability to repeat another 2 hours of this. We'll do it in 10 minutes, just a few points to conclude what we missed. So, and then we move on. After Simcha, we will speak about Deaga, being worried. One of the main claims against the person is not that he was not religious. We are now assuming that the person is considered to be religious, but it's not enough. Many people say, what do you want from me? I'm religious. I keep Shabbat, I eat kosher, I even learn an hour a day. You know, I make blessing when I eat, I make bracha. My wife goes to the mikveh, my children are in yeshivot, you know, I keep the holidays, I walk with yarmulke and tzitzit. What else do you want? I'm religious, I believe in God. It's not enough. Don't try to give yourself discounts, you won't get anywhere. People that are looking for discounts in their life, shortcuts, they won't get anywhere. We have to see what Hashem wants, not what we want. Not our evil inclination dictate for us what's good enough and what's not good enough. That's not the right way. So one of the things in the Torah is, it's scary. It's really scary, literally it's scary. People don't like to hear the truth, you know how it is. Somebody has to say the truth, what can we do? Tachat asher lo avadta et Hashem Elokecha besimcha uvetuv levav. I'm not complaining to you that you did not worship your God or did not follow His instructions. No, you did. Assuming you are. I mean, the majority of the people in the world today are far away from even keeping anything. I'm talking about people who wants to be real and wants to be good and wants to follow the commandment. Once we finally do it, there is still a complaint. What's the complaint? You did not do it with happiness, with joy, with a smile, with a laugh, with desire. Technically, you should have run on the street screaming with tears of joy. I'm a Jew. I'm the son of God. I'm connected to Him. He cares about me. He gave me the Torah from 7.5 billion people. I'm one of the only people that have the truth in His hand. I'm able to live according to this truth. How can I not be happy? How can I complain about a ticket I got or a bad deal in a business or I don't know what? Nonsense. Temporary nonsense. So a person should be minimum. That's the minimum requirement. It's not being righteous like some people think. Wow, this guy is very righteous. Why is righteous? He has love for the commandments. That's the minimal requirement. That should be from every ordinary Jew. Not even talking about big rabbis here. Well, we went so low that if we see a person is happy to do mitzvot and he gets up early in the morning and he runs to the synagogue to pray, and when he put tefillin with such desire, or when he learns, or when he does chesed, or anything he does with such devotion, we are so impressed. Wow! Finally, 1 out of 1,000. Look at him. But really, that's the requirement from every ordinary person. Everyone. What do we see? Alamata shelo nitztavenu al simcha. Sheishkach bayotzer hakol. You should know that the complaint is, if you're not happy, something is not right here. Many of the mitzvot, it's in direct connection to happiness. On holidays, if you're not happy, you cannot fulfill the obligation. When you learn Torah, you're going to be happy. Pikudei Hashem Yesharim Mesamchei Lev. It makes the heart happy. Ve'yadata im levavcha ki ka'asher yaser ish et bno kach Hashem Elokecha miyasreka. You should know the way a person is strict with his son, that's how your God is strict with you. So you shouldn't complain. If you know it's for your own good, if a doctor cut your chest to save your life, open heart surgery, or ballooning. I have a cousin, he's my age, 49. More than 20 years he's in karate in Israel. Why is he in karate? He looks exactly like Bruce Lee. You know Bruce Lee's face? He looks a little bit Japanese. Since we are kids, everyone in the family called him Bruce Lee. When you call your son a name, eventually he becomes that. He went into karate. Karate, you have training. He's not overweight, very muscular, doesn't smoke, doesn't drink alcohol, doesn't touch drugs, and Baruch Hashem have enough money, more than the average people. So he shouldn't be in a category of people that are subject to get a heart attack when they're 49 years old, no? A few days ago, I get an email from his sister, my cousin. Pray for him. He just had a ballooning in his heart. So, ma, ballooning him? Such an athletic guy? How can it be? I waited, it was the middle of the night. I waited for the morning, I called him. It was after the procedure. He said to me, you don't understand, 2 a.m. I had such pressure in my chest. It's like putting a refrigerator on my chest. That's how heavy it was. I thought maybe it's food, maybe it's gas. I didn't know what to think. Who would think someone like me has a cardiac arrest soon? What happened? He said to his wife, take me to the hospital. They're lucky, they have a hospital not far from their house. They went to the hospital. They put him in a bed. They're just beginning to check blood pressure, you know, the regular stuff. The nurse, before she understands what's going on, they leave the patients in a room and go. Especially 3 a.m. No one is in the hospital. They barely have any doctors. Look how critical it is when they try to cut on workers. People are dying because of that. While he's there on the table, on a bed, he actually had a heart attack. His heart stopped to work. If his wife was not there with him, if he was in a situation to go to the hospital on his own, meaning the pain would not be so strong, then he would drive by himself. He would be dead. The only reason he got saved, of course, it's all from Hashem, but the only reason he got saved is because his wife was there and started to scream. Otherwise, he would die. That's it. By the time they realize he's dead, he's dead. That's it. You don't need more than a minute here. She started to scream, and they came. They gave him the shocks and brought him back to life. For a minute or two, the heart was not working. So you see, you don't know. I ask him, what's this? Nobody understands. He can be the healthiest guy, supposedly. No cholesterol, no nothing. Sometimes he can be the other way around. Overweight, smoking, drugs, high cholesterol, no exercise, who knows what. And the heart worked to 90. Why? There is a boss to the world. In the end, it's all his decision. He always liked to do things in a natural way, that's true. But when he needs something to get done, natural, not natural, it will get done. So a person should know that all the problems and the struggle in his life, it's for his own good. I got an email a few hours ago from Israel. A woman that became religious from my CDs in Israel. Her and her daughters. I don't know, she didn't say a word about the husbands. I don't know if she's divorced or she's married, but the husband did not become religious, but she did not mention him. Me and my daughters became addicted to the lectures. We don't go to sleep before we listen to minimum 2 hours every night. And now, Baruch Hashem, if my daughters don't behave, I tell them tonight they won't have lectures. Immediately they behave. Baruch Hashem, it's working. That's her words. So now she said that she has another son, and he has a very, very rare disease. That usually nobody makes it to age 20 with this kind of disease. Paralyzed, on a wheelchair. I don't remember the name of it. It's a very complicated word. And she said that he's 25? No, it's not. I never heard of that word before. So he's 25. The doctor's surprised. He should have begun by 20. So tomorrow he has a critical test to see if he's going to leave or not. He has some kind of a problem now. So I had to write to her that if something happened to him in the next few days and he passed, to understand that it's for our own good, to be happy about it. He's finished his tikkun. You know, all these special needs kids, autistic, Down syndrome, paralyzed, handicaps, all these people that come to the world with already problems, usually, if you have reviewed the Shaar HaGilgulim of the Ari HaKadosh and some Kabbalah, other Kabbalah books, is people that are almost fixed. They're in a level of close to 100% already. They need to struggle X amount of years, and they get the soul is being corrected, they have a tikkun, and they're done. They don't have to be reincarnated again. And everybody cries for them and feels for them and feel horrible how much they suffer, which is not normal, especially the mother. But if people understand the truth, they know that they are luckier than us. They are closer to correction than us. We have a long way to go. Yeah, we feel okay, we're not suffering pain, we're not handicapped, we don't have mental issues, fine. But in the long run, who's closer to the goal? Those are the people that are closer to their goal. They may be here for the last year or two of their life, and they don't have to ever come back here in another body. And we may have to come again and again. Maybe we have to go through Gehenom to get cleansed, the soul, which is a terrible suffering. It's a long way in our journey. We don't know. But usually that's how it is. Everything is the other way around. Of what people understand, what the truth is, most of the time is two opposites. So everything that happened to you, you should still be happy. Should never make you upset and sad. Why? Because if everything works for you perfectly, and you became religious, and now still everything is working smoothly and perfectly, and money comes, and no health problem, no marriage problem, no problems with the children, no problem with the government, no problems, nothing. Everything works beautifully. That's a very concerning phenomena. Why? When exactly are you going to pay for all your crimes? You're going to pay for your crimes eventually. If everything working for you, that means your repentance is not accepted yet. That's not a good sign. Because like everything else in life, there are rules how to make repentance. And there are many sins that require suffering. Without suffering, there's no way to erase the sins. No way. And if there's no suffering, 20 years you're religious and there's no suffering. Business is booming. Everything is nice. You just got married. You have one kid after the other. You become richer every day. You're healthy. You're happy. Everyone loves you. Where exactly is the repentance here? How are you going to pay for all the Shabbat you broke? And all the Avodah Zarah, and all the Chametz of Pesach, and all the Lashon Hara, and who knows what? When exactly are you going to pay for it? So you should know, if this is the case, that means Hashem is paying you in this world, because you don't have a share to the next world. In English, it's called penny wise, dollar foolish. You know what it means, penny wise, dollar foolish? Give me the penny now. I don't want to wait for the dollar tomorrow. I said, if you wait tomorrow, you get a dollar. No, give me now a penny. Many people want reward right away. They keep some mitzvot. Immediately, they want to get rewarded. But the Torah says clearly that the righteous people, the reward is waiting for them to the next world. Clearly, it's a verse in the Torah. The righteous people, I delay the reward. And the wicked people, I pay them instantly to get rid of them. So the payment here, it's the beginning of his destruction. Who wants such a payment? It's like a father said to his son, I don't want to wait until I die to give you your share in my inheritance. Come, here is your check. Get out of my house. I don't want to ever see your face. That's a reward or that's an insult? It's an insult. Some fools would smile. I got my money now. I don't have to wait another 10 years. But a clever guy said, what kind of a reward is that? It's the biggest shame. That my father kicked me out, doesn't want to see my face. Your father in this world, anyway, it's temporary. No, he doesn't like you, he doesn't want you. No, he can still leave. But if your father in heaven kick you out and he pay you your reward in this world because he doesn't want anything to do with you in the next eternal world, then it's a disaster. And it's not just a shame, it's a disaster. It's a destruction. One more thing. In order for a person to be happy, he must always have confidence in God. The more you fear about the future, financially, medically, or all kinds of concerns that you have, it takes away your happiness. There's no way to live in fear about what's coming to you in your future and at the same time to be happy in Avodat Hashem. There's no such thing. The way to be happy is to live with full confidence. What's going to happen? I'm not worried. But you may die in 6 months. You have cancer. No problem. What? You don't want, you're not worried? No. Why you not worried? I have 6 months to do tshuva. And I met repentance. When I die, I go to a good place. I count on Hashem. I have no problem. Yeah, but children, Hashem takes care of the children anyway. It will continue. And this, there's always excuses. Person, he has confidence that whatever Hashem does is for his own good. Nothing basically concerns him. Nothing. Only will I make it to heaven or not. That's it. The rest is not so important. It's written clearly, throw everything on Hashem and he will perform for you. U'ichalkelecha. That's only if you count on him. You throw on him and you worry what is he going to do. Of course he's not going to perform. If you throw everything on him and you know Hashem is going to do it for me, I count on him. He never let me down. Then he'll do it for you because you count on him. Also, it prevents fear from people. You're not worried, you're not fearing police, you're not fearing the neighbor, you're not fearing the mafia, you're not fearing your brother, you're not fearing your partner, you're not fearing anyone. There's nothing to fear. Or you're not afraid this guy wants to kill you. I tell you what happened. You know, sometimes a person thinks, for instance, he has a bad dream. Like I remember one time it happened to me. I was supposed to fly to L.A. I think it was Friday morning for Shabbaton. 4 or 5 in the morning, I have a dream that my plane crashed. What a crash. And now in 2 hours, I have a flight. Imagine to get on a plane when you actually saw, and dreams of the morning usually are more real. So you see now in your dream that the plane is going to crash. I have to go to Shabbaton with hundreds of people to bring them closer to Hashem. So now it's a war between your brain and your heart. Your heart says, don't be a fool. Hashem sent you a warning. The plane is going to crash. Don't go. Then your brain say, cannot be. I'll crash. How can I crash? I go, there's going to be 500-600 people. Maybe 50 of them become Shomrei Shabbat. I'm on my way to an important holy mission. If I have to die, I die with or without this plane. If I don't have to die, you know, so what am I worried about? And even sometimes if you have to die, since you're busy in such an important mitzvah, you get saved. The mitzvah can save you. Shliuchei mitzvah enam nizokim. There's a rule. When you're on the way to an important mitzvah, you have a special protection. So after some doubts that I had, I got on a plane. I went. Very smooth ride. You know? No problem. No turbulence. No nothing. Shh. Right away, why? The Satan saw that something big is about to happen. Got me scared. It's such a dream. You have to count on Hashem, not on your feelings. Why don't you go? I have a bad feeling. Where did feeling come from? Feeling. What, you became a prophet? Feeling. I have a bad feelings. A lot of people, I have bad feelings. You understand? We don't go by guessing. None of us is prophet. We don't go by sign. You see a black cat crossing the street, it's a good sign. White cat, also a good sign. No cat, also a good sign. No difference. With a cat, without a cat, black, white, all nonsense. If it's going to be rain tomorrow, it's a bad sign. I shouldn't do it. If it's going to be sunny, it's a good sign. If one person will come to me in the morning, will be tzaddik, it's a good sign. If it will be someone else, bad sign. All this nonsense that people do. Do you know how many times the Satan uses your stupidity to fool you? Let's open the book and see if I have to go back to Israel or not. The Satan says, oh, great idea. You're supposed to stay here. He has good learning, he has good parnasa, his children are great yeshivot, his wife is happy, he has shalom bayit, everything is working for him. But Yetzer Hara play with his head, leave everything you have and go on an adventure. Don't get me wrong, it's a very big mitzvah to make aliyah to Eretz Yisrael. You live in Eretz Yisrael, every step is a mitzvah. It's a different league over there. But now, maybe it's not the right time yet. So how do you know? Definitely by opening a book, that's not the answer. The Satan see that that's what you follow, all of a sudden he's going to open now on mitzvah to go to Eretz Yisrael. Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash. You see? Hashem told me the answer. I must go to Israel. He goes to Israel. His children all became not religious after 2-3 years. They didn't get accepted to yeshivot. He had to send them to public school. I don't have to tell you the rest, right? If your children became goyim, what difference does it make the rest? You make millions in Israel. Your wife is happy. What is it? It's not relevant anymore. Most important thing is what's going to happen with your family. They all become mechalelei Shabbat. You know one rabbi in the world that tell you, go to Israel even if your kids become mechalelei Shabbat? No, right? Now, don't get me wrong. Not that I say that that's what's going to happen to someone who goes to Israel. Sometimes it's exactly the other way around. Over here, your kids were not something great, and they went to Israel, and you put them in a good place, and they had better friends, and they became very righteous. Sometimes it's the right time to go. Sometimes it's the wrong time to go. In order for you to know, you have to go to your rabbi, to a very big rabbi, explain to him everything goes in your life, and tell him, tell me what to do, rabbi. Not by making lottery. If I see a black cat today, it's a sign I have to stay here. If I see a white cat, that's a sign that I'll buy tickets and we move to Israel next month. Maybe the goyim do this. Maybe the goyim guess. But Bilam said in his blessing, that was supposed to be a curse, but in the end it was a prophecy, that it said, Velo nachash be Yaakov. Nachash means guessing. The Jews don't go by guessing. Or by dates. Many people today, they want to buy a house. So they call one of the babot. Baba X, Baba Y, I want to buy a house. The address is number such and such. Oh, I see very bad luck in this house. The number is not good. In the end, he loses the house. $200,000 profit he just lost because of this Baba and his hallucinations. That's the right way? Since when it goes by that? You understand? Many of the things that penetrated Judaism from the culture of the goyim, that they like to guess, all kinds of things like that. But that's not the way we go. We have to ask da Torah based on the situation of a person. This is what my life is. I have a chavruta, I don't have. I have a yeshiva to learn. I don't have a yeshiva. My kids have a good environment. They don't have. My wife is depressed. She's not happy here. My parnasa, I have problems with the police, the FBI. You have to tell the whole picture. Move from here to here. And what city should I go in Israel? To this city. And that's it. Where should I go? Stay right where you are. Don't move. Ask me again in a year. Ask me again in 2 years. That Torah. We have to understand that we shouldn't go by guessing and by lottery. It's not a bingo game, you know, what number came up. One more thing is everything good that happens to you, first of all, it's not guaranteed that it's good. It may look good right now, but it's a beginning of a destruction later on. And what looks bad may be in the end the best thing that ever happened to you. But what you consider right now good, you have to know 100% is from Hashem. Nothing is thanks to you. It's not thanks to your college degree. It's not thanks to your wife. It's not thanks to your rabbi. It's not thanks to your uncle. It's not thanks to your in-laws. Yes, maybe they were the messengers. And you owe them a lot of gratitude. Yes, because that's the way Hashem made the world. That someone does a favor to you, no matter who he is, you owe him a gratitude, even though the good came from Hashem, not from him. It was just the mailman to hand you the envelope or the check or the bag or the car or whatever the case was. But the real good came from Hashem. All the good come from Hashem. All the bad come from Hashem. All the bad is not bad, it's also good. There's no such thing bad. In a situation you're in right now, is the best thing that happened to you. Relatively, compared to where you put yourself. You make sins, you make crimes, you force Hashem to put you over here to cure you. The cure is painful, but it's not bad. It looks bad, but it's very good. Surgery is good or bad? Depends who you ask. If you ask a fool, it will say bad. Look how much he suffered. If you ask a genius, he says it's very good. It saves his life. Without the surgery, he'll be dead next week, right? One more thing. Nobody can add or decrease from what Hashem wants you to have. Don't ever fight with people about money. Don't sue people. Get yourself to a level you don't have to fight with anyone about money. Not in court, not in person. Whatever is mine is mine. Whatever is not mine is not mine. Move on. If you don't have confidence in Hashem, you need the court. What can you do? Otherwise, you won't sleep at night for years. You'll die from a heart attack. So go to the rabbis to decide what to do with you. But if you have confidence in Hashem, who can take what's mine? Nobody can touch it. And if somebody took it, that means it wasn't mine. That's it. End of story. And one more thing. Hashem knows who you are without fooling him. You can fool people only. But you cannot fool Hashem. If your rabbi is clever, you cannot fool him. A clever, experienced Talmid Chacham, he knows who you are by the way you walk, by the way you move, before you even open your mouth. Needless to say, after you open your mouth. Needless to say, after he knows you for a few years and see you on a daily basis, then it's needless to say. If he doesn't see you, something is not right about him. Either he doesn't have experience, or lo shimesh, he's not Talmid Chacham enough. Yeah, okay, no one is perfect. But a real Talmid Chacham, by the way a person look, he already know if he's proud or humble. By the way a person look. By the way a person behave in a lecture, I can write a book about him. How he moves, how he sit, how many times he touch his face, what part of his face he touch, how does he move his knees, his hands, how he leans back, how he leans forward, how he moves in a chair, if he moves to the right side, to the left side. He gets up, come back, gets up, come back, playing with his phone, moving around, looking up, looking down. Do you know how many things you can know about a person? Ask an FBI investigator. They have courses about it for months. How to detect if a person is lying before lie detector. In the first investigation, 90% of the time immediately in the first conversation they had with the suspect, they already know if he's the murderer or not. Everyone is an actor. Oh my God. Oh, the biggest murderer, he just murdered his wife and he pretends he's crying. You understand? But a good detective immediately knows. A good detective immediately knows. Look at his hand, look at scratches, look at, you know, a lot of things you can know. Unbelievable. So, everything in the end is from Hashem. No one can touch it. So why are you eating your heart so much? Hashem reads your mind. Hashem knows the future. Hashem sees the entire movie. You only see a minute. You want to tell him what to do? He's the director of the film. Just count on him. Be happy and relax. And always remind yourself, it's all for good. One more thing and we can move on. Make sure your wishes and your will, it's His will. What you wish that happens in the world should be what He wishes. For instance, you hate abomination. Why you hate abomination? Not because it's disgusting. Because Hashem hates it. Make sure that you adjust your mind and your will and your decisions and your ideology to be exactly like Hashem's ideology and mind and the things He loves and the things He hates. So when we put you close to what Hashem said in the Torah, one by one it's going to be V. Love abomination or hates abomination? Many religious Jews, they pour abomination, as we know. Recently we learned. They have no problem about the despicable parades that they do. What do you care about them? Let them, if they love it, I don't have a problem with that. Right there, you're not religious. But I'm Shomer Shabbat. So what? The many goyim also Shomer Shabbat. They're not Jewish, they're not religious. Shomer Shabbat, very nice of them. So what? But I eat kosher. Go to Costco. Most of the kosher products are sold to non-Jewish people. Definitely they're not religious Jews. So what are you going to say? You have a yarmulke? 1 billion Muslims have a yarmulke. So what? I don't get it. What? You have no problem with the parade of abomination of people who rebel against God? You cannot call yourself religious. Not Orthodox, not modern Orthodox, nothing. You're not religious. You have secular ideology. Ideology is more important than actions because the actions can never be correct with the rotten ideology. First, you have to fix your computer, your ideology. Then it will reflect in your actions when you do the mitzvot. No wonder a lot of these modern people that they have the university ideology and the ideology of the Greeks, their mitzvot looks exactly like their faces, if you know what I mean. They have an expression in Israel, כמו הפרצוף שלו. Even if he's handsome, it means negative. Meaning the mitzvot are 20% good, 30% good, never 100% good, never. Always like they say in Israel, חפיף. You know what חפיף means? יאללה, push it, let's go, let's finish already. אשרי יושבי ביתך, התגדל והתקדש. יהיו לרצון עם רפי ויגון לפניך הצורי, אנא השם, תחתנו, אבינו, sit down, get up, עלינו לשבח, 2.5 minutes, and he's back in his car. And he thinks he's going to get a reward for praying. Why is like that? It begins with a rotten ideology. Go and test. Go to some of these places. I'm not saying names. You test it for yourself. Places that they call themselves modern. If you make the confession one time, you get a prize from me. Let's do a test. Go to places that call themselves modern Orthodox. Without saying names, I hope I'm wrong. I hope you come back to me and tell me that you deserve a prize. I will be very happy. Just when they begin, Ana Hashem, Ashamnu, Bagadnu, you need to think about it, about what you say. If you say the entire list, and you finish with them or before them, you get a prize. Usually the way it is, by the fourth or fifth word that you say, they already sit and they finish. Okay, you ask yourself, what kind of confession is this? In Israel, it has a name for it, chafif. Remember this word, chafif. Chafif means, just do it. Who cares how? Finish! Finish, you know, like the cleaning lady that they push all the dirt under the wall unit? That's what it means, chafif. Chafif. Every boss knows which worker is chafif and which worker is serious. You know, when this guy is in a night shift, tomorrow morning you have to dive under the wall units and under the beds and check what's under there. And if the other worker was last night, you know, you don't have to ever check. When one worker was there, you have to check the camera for 3 hours the next morning. When the other worker was there, you don't even have to turn the camera on. Why are you not filming? It's this guy Moshe. There's nothing to worry about. Why? That's what King Solomon said. Tov shem mi shemen tov. Shemen used to be very expensive. Oil back in the time used to be handmade, hand pressing. It was very expensive for the rich people, oil. That's why they said someone who light Shabbos candle with oil, his children will be Talmidei Chachamim, to give incentive to the people to invest money in buying oil for the candle. Today, you come, you buy $5, you buy enough food for a month or two. Even though it's considered still expensive, but it's still very, very cheap compared to what it used to be. So back in time, 3,000 years ago, oil was mamash fancy. So someone who had a lot of oil, that means he was a very lucky person. So King Solomon say, better your reputation than any amount of oil you have. Tov shem mi shemen tov. And also he said one more thing. The time of your death is better than the time of your birth. If you ask every secular person in the world, Jew or non-Jew, doesn't matter, what day is better in your life, the day you were born or the day you died? Do you know one person would say the day I died? Maybe if he was on Prozac and he was very depressed, yes. Yes, some people would say, oh, the day I came to the world is the most scarce day of my life, because he had a horrible life. So the death, it's a relief for him. But people that have okay life, which day they memorize more? Do they celebrate the time they die, or they celebrate the time they're born? Birthday, no? But King Solomon said, the day you die is better than the day you are born. Why? The day you're born, that means you restart your test. You failed the previous one. You have to start another test. The day you died, if you're righteous, you go to heaven. It's the day of collecting the prize. What's better? The day you enter the test, you want to be a doctor. So now there's a test, if you're going to be a doctor or not. 4-hour test. The day you enter the test, the second you enter the test, or after you got the diploma and you found a job as a great surgeon in a hospital. Which one is better? When you're done with the test, no? But today everything is the opposite, because people don't understand what life is, what death is, what coming back to the world is, reincarnations, what happens after death. No, you need to learn. If you don't learn, you don't know anything. So make sure your will is like his will. You want everyone to be Shomer Shabbat. Why? Because that's what he wants. You don't want people to have mercy on terrorists, Muslim or non-Muslim, doesn't matter. Murderers from all nations. People who go and kill innocent people just because they don't like them or whatever the case is. So that's something God hates. So you should hate it. And God hates gay marriage. It's against his Torah. So everyone who supports it is not religious, is wicked. Doesn't matter if he calls himself religious. Someone like this you cannot let pray in a synagogue. When he has a yortzeit, he says, I want to be shliach tzibur. If you're the rabbi of the place, tell him you're lucky I'm letting you entering the shul. You support gay marriage and you want to come to my shul? If I had a shul and someone would tell me I support gay marriage, on my dead body he would enter the shul. I said to him, no, I don't care if this shul will be closed, but you won't come here. You not only as a part of the minyan, even as 11 and 12, you're not going to come in. First go fix your head, become Jewish, become religious, then come to the synagogue. You understand? I'm not talking someone who just became religious yesterday and we still have to work on his head to clean it from all the nonsense that they pushed in the university. Someone like that, mitzvah to bring him in and teach him. I'm talking someone who's religious all his life. Rabbi, it's no problem. What's the problem? You understand? Or always kissing up to the nations. Will do everything he can to find favor in their eyes. Look at this. Go to the universities. Check carefully who is behind all the bans against Israel. 9 out of 10 times will be Jews. Liberal Jews. Check. Someone sent me today a 20-minute film. They interview somebody, I guess he's famous, I don't know who he is. He brings proofs how all the problem comes to the Jews from Jews. And he gives few examples. Yeah. If you want, you can contact me, I'll send you that video. I wasn't the first one who spoke about it. Apparently there are other people who speak about it. And he's not even religious, this guy. Just a Jew. He speaks about his experience in universities with other Jews, what they do against Judaism and against Israel. Then they complain about the French, the Germans, the Arabs. First, clean your own house. What do you worry about the neighbors? Your own house, you have cancer. Get rid of the cancer in your house, then you worry about the neighborhood, then you worry about the city, then you worry about the country. First, you clean your own house. If your house is dirty, what do you worry about the street? What's more important, that your house will be clean or the streets will be clean? For you, as an individual, you start with your own bedroom, and then the living room, and then the lobby, and then the street, and then the city, and then the country, and then the world. There's priorities. Make sure when you see a collision between your ideology and God's ideology, meaning what you think, someone just showed you in the Torah that it's the opposite of the Torah or the Talmud, immediately, and the next time you pray, please God forgive me, I didn't know, I'm sorry. It was an innocent mistake, I didn't know you hate it. The rabbi just showed me, or I just heard in a speech, that it says in the Tanakh you hate this kind of things, and I didn't know, I didn't think it's a problem. I apologize. I cancel my opinion. Once I know that you hate it, I'm not saying anything. It doesn't matter what I think. You say that this is what you like, I like it. You say this is what you hate, I hate it. Everyone who hates you, God, I hate them. Everyone who loves you, I love them. Everyone who is following you, I love them. I want to be with them. Everyone who go against you and rebel against you, I hate them. I don't want anything to do with them. That's the right way to think. Forget about politically correct ideology. It went bankrupt already. That's it. It doesn't have room anymore in the world. The faster people realize it, the better it is. Being politically correct is a nice word of being a liar. Covering the lies. It's all a lie. It's all fake. It's all kiss up. It's all kissing up to wicked people and to murderers and to filthy and dirty politicians and to terrorists and to countries who wants to destroy the world like Obama did with Iran, gave them $150 billion. Today, one of the Israeli head of the army in a very special interview, mamash like a confession, he said that the damage that Obama made with Iran cannot be reversed and cannot be fixed. It's just a matter of time until a disaster will happen. So the damage that Obama made to the world, not only to Israel, to the whole world, because Iran can shoot a bomb on Saudi Arabia, not only on Israel, can shoot on the United States. If North Korea had a missile who can reach the United States, count on the Iranians that they have just as good missiles. The damage that Obama made, it will take time for all the people in the world to realize it. Now only the expert knows. It cannot be fixed. If they make now all kinds of rules to cancel the agreement, it's not going to help anymore. Iran is on a fast marathon to destroy the world, like they dream. They promote more terrorism. They spread more cancer all over the world. They sponsor Hezbollah and Hamas and all kinds of people that do only bad in the world. And Obama kissed up to them. He ruined the relationship with Israel. That was the best friends and the same ideology of America, democracy and all the rest of the nonsense. And he went and became, he kissed up to Iran that was destroyed and bankrupt. No one will ever understand such a thing, how Hussein did such a thing. If you think that the reason he did it because his name is Hussein, most of the Arabs in the world is bad for them, Iran, the way Obama made them. It's bad for the Arabs also. It's not good for any Arab country. It's against the entire Middle East. It's only good maybe for Hezbollah, Syria maybe, that's it. It's bad for Iraq, it's bad for Saudi, it's bad for Kuwait, it's bad for Bahrain, it's bad for everyone. So it's bad for all the other Arabs as well. So what did Obama achieve by that? Only Hashem knows. Hashem has many messengers. Ki en le'Hashem ma'atzor le'oshia. Berov u'beme'at. Hashem has no limitation. Sometimes people say, Rabbi, I'm only a teacher. How am I going to make enough money to marry my 6 children in 3 years? I need $300,000 and I make $40,000 a year. Plus, I need to pay my expenses. Theoretically, I cannot even save enough to marry one of the kids. Forget about 6. People that speak like that, they have very strong defect in the faith and religion. How can you call yourself religious when you don't count on Hashem? How? You have to count on Hashem. All the people in the world that got married, they were all rich? They all came from a millionaire family? No! The majority of the people in the world are poor. And in reality, millions of people getting married, poor, and somehow they all make it. They have a place to live. They have food to eat. So they don't live in a palace, no. But Whatever they need, whatever Hashem wants them to have, they get. Against all odds. Billions of miracles are done every day in the world for these people. You ignore all of it and you worry, oh, I'm not going to have what to eat. My children's not going to have a wedding. Do you know how many people in America don't get married because of financial lack of confidence? Why you don't get married? I'm not even going on a date. I was in L.A. Two brothers came to me, close to 40 years old, 36 and 38. Gave a lecture. I spoke to people about 4 or 5 hours after the lecture. It was already middle of the night. They waited to the end. And then they came to me, and one of them told me, Rabbi, I did not go on a date even once. Nice looking guys. Why? I can't afford to get married. Why you can't afford? How am I going to get a house? I'm in LA, it's costing a lot of money. The girls have high demands. How am I going to get married? He doesn't want to go on a date because for him it's a waste of time. Why? Because if he finally meet the right religious girl and he wants to finally get married, he's going to need a lot of money for the marriage, for a car, for a wedding ring, for to rent a place or to buy a place. He's going to need over $1 million. That's his calculation. Since anyway I cannot get it, 20 years I'm in business, I didn't get it. What's the point of getting married? That's logic. What about reality? Logic and reality not always the same. Logically, he's right. Logically, he knows how much he makes a year in the last 20 years. In 20 years, he didn't make $1 million. How is he going to make in 3 months $1 million that he needs for a house, for the wedding, for the wedding ring, for all the expenses of the wedding? How is he going to make it? The answer, how all the other people made it? They started very, very simple and moved a little better, a little better. After 20 years, they have children. They married their own children. How? Who would ever believe? I remember my parents and their friends, how when Israel just became a state. The British were there. People used to wait hours online to get food stamps, to get a bag of flour or a piece of bread. Nothing else to eat. Nobody had shoes. People cut the front of the shoes. 8 sons wearing the same pair of shoes. There's no, the size doesn't match. They cut the front. The toes goes out. That's how our people in the neighborhood. Everyone was poor. Nobody had more than one outfit. Who could ever afford anything luxury? That's how they all grew up. Horrible condition. Showers, they had to go outside in the winter with a special tool. There was no faucets. Everything nice, marble, ceramic, jacuzzi almost in every house today, mirrors, Italian imported marble in a bathroom. Rabbi, this bathroom cost me $200,000. Look at this. See how the light goes on? 3 times, it goes off. Wow. He lights his cigarette with such happiness. Is sitting in a $200,000 toilet. The whole street back then did not cost $200,000. The whole street, from all the way from here and miles away. But they all somehow made it, and they married their children and grandchildren. And that's the way it was. Ask them if you don't believe. That's how it was. In the end, people made it. Even people that didn't deserve to make it. The Mechalelei Shabbat, the wicked, they also made it. You understand? So, make the Torah the main thing in your life and everything else secondary. Not the other way around like most people do. One more thing you have to have confidence in is that you have to clean your mind and your actions and always pray to Hashem to show you the right path. Adricheni be'amitecha velamdeni. Amitecha means your truth. Direct me to your truth and teach me. And another place it says, Adricheni bentiv mitzvotecha. Derech emuna bacharti. I chose a way with a path, with a fate, path of fate. Direct me into the path of your mitzvot. Pray for two things. One, make my heart strong in faith and emuna, and clean all the burdens of the world from my mind. Don't make me worry. Help me not to ever be worried, to relax, to count on you 100%. You have nothing to worry about. Pray for your health. Do ishtadlut. You can make some efforts to make a living, no problem. Do an effort, adraba, it's necessary. But don't kill yourself, don't overkill yourself. Give a lot of charity. Many of the people, as soon as business go down, the first thing they do, they cut the charity. Smart people double the charity when business begin to go down. One 24 years old guy that give money every month to the CDs called me today to ask me, Rabbi, I work for my father and I make a very nice salary. Father has a nice company. I don't like the job there. I want to go on my own. I want to take a loan from my father and I'm going to start my own business and I'll pay him back. But I want to do something else. So he is asking, should he do it or not? I have to ask him a lot of questions to know the good and bad on both sides. Then he said, I said to him, well, you don't have expenses so much. Still live by your family, you eat there. You don't really have expenses. Not like you have a family that you have to pay tuition, yeshivot, you need $10,000, $20,000 a month. So Baruch Hashem, you don't have all of that yet. So he said to me, no, but I still want to give you $100 a month for the CDs. So I said to him, no, but if you're taking a loan, you don't have to give charity. You give charity from what you make, not from a loan you took. So he said to me, no, I don't want to be like these fools that when the business go down or the income stop, first thing they do, they cut the charity. Charity I don't touch. No matter what I give, even if for now I'm borrowing X amount of money, I still want to give them monthly. Ask someone that has 1,000 times more money than this kid. First thing he cut is the charity. Unbelievable. Not that he doesn't have, he has plenty. Ah, you gave me less? I'll give you less. Measure for measure, no Hashem. Get the business back to the way it used to be. I'll give you back the way I used to give. Very, very smart, measure for measure. He's doing with Hashem. He's teaching Hashem a Musar. You know, don't mess with me. You're nice to me, I'll be nice to you. One guy told me, when I'll get married, I'll be Shomer Shabbat. I say, why? When you're single, you cannot be Shomer Shabbat? He says, much, much harder. Now I have a wife, I'll be together with her, we eat together, we talk, not alone. I say, I never saw in the Torah that it says you only have to keep Shabbat when you're with someone else. But when you're alone, since it's hard, we understand that you're lonely. I never saw any exception to the rule in any book, not only on the Torah, anywhere. So I said to him, you know what? Maybe because this is the way you speak and this is the way you think, maybe you'll never be married. This was 20 years ago. Back then he was 38. You do the math, how old is he today? Never got married. You make conditions to Hashem, you testing Hashem. There's only one thing you're allowed to test Hashem. If you give 10% from your net income for a good charitable cause, most of the people, their charity is a sin. I repeat, most of the people, Jews and non-Jews, by the non-Jews it's obvious, they give money to the church, it's all idol worshipping. Definitely it's a sin. Muslims that give money to all kinds of mosques who preach to kill people, to kill the Jews, to kill Americans, for sure this charity is a sin as well. Hindus and Buddhists, it's also idol worshipping. So it's very bad. All this charity is bad. Jews that give donations to reform and conservative synagogues, it's all a sin. Jews that give money to hospitals, thinking, at least I'm going to cure miserable sick people. Right? Not necessarily. If you donate money to a hospital in Israel, half of the patients over there are Arabs, and a large portion of them are Hamas terrorists or supporting Hamas and murdering Jews. You don't want your money to cure these monsters. You want them cleaned from the world ASAP by giving money to the hospital because you want to see your name and your wife's name on a building. You're not considering that you're reviving murderers on a daily basis. That's also a sin. You understand? Now you understand how you have to think. You don't just follow the world. Use your head. Where to invest your money? Kosher yeshiva, people sit and learn Torah with poverty. Fantastic. CDs, USBs, giving it to people. Today I got a recording from my guy, Shammai, used to live here in Queens. He is running the all operation of the CDs in Israel. He got a call a month ago. An Israeli guy found a box. Half full. You know, boxes come 1,000 CDs, the ones we order from China. Half full. Hundreds of CDs in a box. Someone left it by a building. It was neglected there in a corner. He found it. He saw the telephone numbers on a CD. A secular guy. He called him up. Excuse me, I found a box with CDs of Rabbi Mizrachi. What should I do? So he said to him, wow, thank you very much for calling. Would you mind keeping the box with you and give me your address? I'll send someone to pick up the box so that he can give the CDs out. Yes, of course. He gave him the address. He sent one of our helpers, volunteers. He took the box and gave it out. That was a month ago. Now he got a call from the guy from a month ago. Excuse me, sir, remember me? I'm the one who found the box a month ago and you sent someone to pick it up, yes? I have to confess, I was very curious to see what's on the CD. So I kept one for myself. And the whole month I'm listening nonstop. Do you have more of them? I became addicted. It's becoming religious now. Here is the power of one CD. 30 hours of lecture, $1 in America, 20-something cents in China, with the shipping, with everything. A gum. How much a bubble gum cost? One in a store, no? 25 cents? A little gum, no? Someone told me they sell loose cigarettes. $1 a cigarette. $1 a cigarette. Loose. I can't believe it. $1 a cigarette. Poison to kill you. Five CDs, or four, four and a half, whatever. You got the point. Saving one or two souls for one stupid cigarette. Our person won't kill himself. Every time you smoke a cigarette, it may be another potential soul that will get saved for eternity. Think about it. A million cigarettes you will smoke in the next 40 years. How many Baalei Tshuva is those cigarettes? We pay for our desires. What do you think? It's a joke. One more thing. Everyone must be confident 1,000,000,000% that when we die, the reward or the punishment will begin. It's one of the 13 principles of Judaism. If you know you're righteous, count on your place in Olam Haba. It's not an embarrassment. How do you know you have a share to the world to come? Why not? I pray every day. I learn Torah. I keep Shabbat. I give tzedakah. I eat kosher. We keep Tarat Mishpacha. I love Hashem. I work on my midot, on my characters to always be a better person. I believe I have a share to the world to come. Why not? Maybe it won't be immediately when a person dies. It may take a year or two or three after. First, he has to get clean, but it's reserved for him once the time begins. That's it. It's good forever. And in the next world, nobody in this world saw ever the beauty of the next world, the spiritual world. Nobody. I'll read you his words. Ve'en ha'peh yachol lesaper yofi ha'olam ha'u. The mouth cannot describe the beauty of the next world. the pleasure of the soul in a place that Hashem will put the righteous souls. Even by the Gentiles, they have their own department. It's better than any pleasure they ever dreamed about in this world, for the Gentiles. And needless to say, the Jews that have a harder mission with a greater reward. Ve'en ha'ayin yechola lirot ziv hadarash hadrat ha'tzadikim. The eye cannot imagine. You know, in all your life you saw a lot of images. And you have in your mind, when you close your eyes, all kinds of beautiful pictures. None of this picture come even near the beauty of the next world. If you take all the reward of all the people from the day they born until the day they die, from the creation of the world until the end of the world combined, billions of people, 78 years of life, millions of different pleasures to each person in his lifetime, add all of that together, it doesn't come to the pleasure of the soul in 1 hour alone in the next world. יפה שעה אחת של קורת רוח בעולם הבא מכל חיי העולם הזה. 1 hour of pleasure and satisfaction in the next world is greater than this entire world combined. Everything. 1 hour of one individual. Imagine the Jews that would lose it for driving to Macy's on Shabbat. Imagine the pain. Why am I losing it? Because you drove the car on Shabbat. But what did I do? I didn't enjoy this driving. I went to eat lunch. I drove here. I drove... That something like this justified to lose such a reward? Yes. You didn't follow the rules. The rules are very clear. You're going to create fire on Shabbat. You lose your share to the world to come. That's it. We're sorry. It's written clearly. לא תבערו אש בכל מושבותיכם. You create fire, I will cut your soul for eternity. You want to test me? Test me, you'll see what's going to be the end. A smart person will test God on it, if it's written in his book, with no exception to the rule besides life risk. Life risk is the only permission to break Shabbat. That's it. So, in the next world, there's no eating, there's no drinking, there's no intimacy, there's no none of the nonsense that people run after so much here, because that's going to look like a joke compared to the real pleasure that the soul will have over there. It's going to look like a joke. Where does it say? Psalm 31, verse 20. Ma rav tufcha asher tzafanta li re'echa. How huge is your greatness that you reserve to your followers when the time comes. It's a clear verse. Somebody asked, how do you know there's reward when we die? It's written in the Torah. I'm testing you. I'm strict with you to test you. Will you keep my laws or not? That I should reward you in your end. When you die, the reward will begin. There's a lot of verses in the Tanakh about it. Here is another one. How huge is your greatness that you reserve for your followers? Leirecha, those who fear you, those who follow your rules. Abotech b'Hashem mezuman lekabel chesed. You know what's the difference between a person that has confidence in Hashem to a person that does not have confidence in Hashem? Even though if both of them has a yarmulke, what's the difference? You know what? I'll tell you what's the difference. As you can see right here, I'm holding in my hand two cups. One is empty and one is full. Why one of them has water and the other one is empty? Because the empty one has a hole in the bottom. It's not a tool to accept any liquid. No matter how much liquid you put inside, it will drip. That means it's not the proper tool to accept the reward. Same thing over here. The person that has confidence in God is the proper tool to receive his kindness and all the greatness that he wants to give to a person. A person that has no confidence, it's like a person that has a hole in the bottom of his bucket. What's the point of giving him? Anyway, nothing will be reserved. Do you understand what's happening here? And the confidence can never come without faith. Confidence can never ever come faint. Meaning, first you have to know there is a God. Second step, you have to believe everything He promised, even if your eyes for the time being does not see it. You see, people like ISIS, people like Obama, people like the anti-Torah and anti-God celebrate, makes millions, getting $500,000 for a lecture, and a rabbi that comes and speaks for 3 hours, not 40 minutes, doesn't even get money for his gas. Nothing. He has to pay from his own pocket to come to teach Torah. So you wonder to yourself, where is the reward that God promised? The wicked Obama makes $500,000 to speak his nonsense to all the wicked people, and they pay him hundreds of thousands of dollars, or to Hillary, and to the rest of the clowns. And the greatest people on earth, if they're lucky, they pay them $1,000. If they're lucky. Most of them get nothing. So the question is, that's what the Torah promised? No, the Torah promised the opposite. The Torah promised that all the clowns and the wicked people who teach against God and speak against God, they're all going to pay severely for their crimes. But for the time being, it doesn't look like it. That's called emunah. I know what the Torah say. I don't care what my eyes see. In the end, everything will be balanced and adjusted to the right justice because God is not a liar. Anyone here think God is a liar? Everyone think even 1% God is a liar? 1%. The 99% of what He promised will happen, but 1% He tricked us, He lied to us. Do you really think such thing? I know people, I know few people, not a lot, that they're 100% honest, not 99%. Meaning they will never say a lie. They will never deceive a person, never trick a person, never take advantage on a person, never mislead a person. Never, ever, no matter what happened. I knew few people like this in my life. So God is worse than them? He made them, no? Everything they know, it's from Him. So what do you say? That He's tricking us, deceiving us? If He promised us that the wicked people will be severely punished sooner or later, and the righteous people will be severely rewarded sooner or later, do I have to have any fear about His promises, or it's guaranteed money in a bank? Guarantee. So what do you worry about? That's called faith, emunah. So first, there's knowledge there is a God and He gave the Torah. And second, what He's promised will always happen, sooner or later. That's why I always say sooner or later, because not always instant. It may take 20 years, it may take even 100 years. It may happen only in heaven, in the next world. Fine, but it will happen for sure. And after that, after you finally have faith, and you're not confused by what you see and what people do and how the wicked people celebrate and why some righteous people suffer and they're sick and they don't have money and all the things that you see in the world, and you're wondering to yourself, where is the justice? That's called emunah, faith. And after that comes the confidence that everything that happens to me, it's for my own good. I have nothing to worry about. Do you understand the difference between the three? A, knowledge. 100% I know there is a God and He watched the world and He supervised everything and nothing can happen without His approval. That's called knowledge. Second, faith. Whether I see it, whether I don't see it, whether I understand what just happened, whether I don't understand, whether it's against my logic, when I see people kill babies, and I see Holocaust, and I see pogrom, and I see a lot of Mechalelei Shabbat make millions, and I wonder to myself, where are you? Are you sleeping? That's a person that don't have faith. Someone that has faith, smile. The Ramban, when he came to Israel, and he saw Israel is a whole desert and swamp. Now one tree, 750 years ago. He said, this is the greatest thing. Why? The Torah said when the Jews would leave Israel, going to exile, the land will refuse to grow any trees. So even though we are being punished, that's the best proof that the Torah is divine. What person can promise that the land for 2,000 years will not grow any tree? The land of Israel. Can you believe it? It's written in the Torah. When I kick you out of the land, not one tree will grow. והארץ הייתה שממה. Completely empty. No trees. No nothing. Only swamp and desert. Even olive trees. Nothing. And all of a sudden, the Jews came back and became paradise. Paradise. Why? The Ramban said. So you see, that's called fate. 100%. If Hashem promised, that's it. And confidence, now when I know there is a God, and now when I know, don't expect justice immediately. It may take time, but it will for sure happen. The third step is, whatever happened to me, it's for my own good. Even if I don't think so, even if I don't understand. And I'm counting on God to feed me and to take care of all my needs. Why? He obligated himself to feed me and take care of all my needs. All I have to do is to count on him to deliver. That's it. The more I count on him, the more he delivers. The more I count on him, the easier it gets to deliver. The less I count of him, the more I have to sweat. You understand? I just gave you the secret of life in 3 minutes. A, B, and C. The knowledge, faith, and confidence. I have a whole lecture about it. I made it 10 days ago on Thursday. Not the past Thursday, the one before. In the old antique shul that was built in 1920 in Brooklyn. 100 years old shul. Being revived by the new generation of the Baalei Tshuva. Many of the Baalei Tshuva from the CDs became religious, took a shul that was empty for many years, full of dust, cleaned it, fixed the air condition, did everything there. It's a shul. Shul was closed for a long time. Baruch Hashem, every day, it's active now, full of people. It's growing. Nice, you see, you know how they used to build the shul 100 years ago. It's a different style. V'yiftechu b'cha yodei shemecha, it's written. Who can only have confidence in God? Those who know him. There's no one can have confidence in God if he doesn't know him. And the only way to know God is to learn Torah. Or at least to listen to the rabbis that teach Torah. If you didn't do that, how will you ever have confidence in God? How can you have confidence in God when your mortgage is due in 2 days and you have to get $5,000 and you don't have a penny in your account and you're unemployed? If you never learn Torah, you immediately give up. That's it, I'm done. What are you doing? I'm thinking if to jump from the window or not. Why is it? That's it, I'm done. They're going to take away our house. But if you learn Torah, all you have to do is to begin to cry. God, I'm in your hand. You're going to help me. I'm counting on you. Whatever you want, that's what's going to happen. You want me on the street? I'll be more than happy to go to the street if that's what you want. You want me here? I know you want me to pray. You want me to count on you. I am counting on you. What happened? It's not in my hand anymore. You may lose this house, and 5 years later, you move to a much better house in a better area. Do you know why? Because you counted on him 5 years ago. But I lost my house. I counted on him and he made me lose the house. Yeah, but he moved you to a much better neighborhood. There's few people who moved to Muncie from Queens. They took away their homes here. It was very bad. It used to be 9% a year mortgage. It used to be. Now it's 4 and people complain. 4.5. 9%, 9.5% mortgage used to be. Interest rate. That's how it was. More than double than today. Just the interest. People lost their homes. Some of them moved to Muncie. It was much cheaper back then than Queens. Much, much cheaper. Could have bought back then a house in Muncie for $150,000 with 1 acre lot. 1 acre. It's like 4 houses here on the block. It's 1 acre. And they bought over there. And now it's worth 7 times more. Huh? Like 11 houses, yeah. Or zaru ala tzadik ule Yisrael ef simcha. There is a special light that glowing from the seeds of your righteousness. When you're righteous, it's like planting a seed in the ground. This seed will bring light to your soul eventually. Or zaru al tzaddik uleishrei lev simcha. And those honest people, people who don't steal, people that don't cheat, people that don't fight for money, people that don't rob anyone, people that don't deceive, they don't have enemies, they're honest, they never take advantage on anyone. Those are the people who reach the highest level of happiness. No stress. Do you know that most people die from stress? And you know that most of the stress comes from living crooked lifestyle? Stealing. Look at all the mafia people. They all die in the end. And still many people go to organized crime. In Israel, there's mafia. Every week you hear someone else, they put a bomb in his car, this one. They all live, 2, 3, 5, 10 years, flashy lifestyle. They build nice mansion, bodyguards, fancy car, boom, death. His brother, same thing. His other brother, same thing. Everyone kills everyone. Over here in America was the same thing. Every week, another Italian gangster killing here, killing them there. Jewish gangster, Italian gangster, black gangster. They all know they're going to finish bad, and they still run after the fake and corrupted life. Why? Yetzer hara, evil inclination. Someone that does his mitzvot with happiness, his reward is 1,000 times greater. You and your friend learning now, sitting in a class for 2 hours. One is very happy to be here, and one is counting the minutes, when will I run? Oof, it's too long. Why did I even come? Too long, too boring. Ah, another half an hour, I'll die here. Two of them. One say, wow, I wish it will go all the way to the morning. Finally, I came. Maybe it should be to the morning. His friend next to him, oof, when is it going to be over, this torture? They don't get the same reward. The one that is happy gets 1,000 times more than the one that is upset. I just read it to you. I didn't make it up. Kol ha'oseh mitzvot besimcha. Yesh lo sachar 1,000 yadot yoter mimi sha'mitzvot alav lemasa. Someone that the mitzvot, the learning Torah, chesed, charity, whatever he does, it's like heavy weight on his shoulder. Oh, I can't do it anymore. Kills me. His reward is 1,000 times smaller than someone and say, where can I do another mitzvah? No, where? Next, when? Where is the next opportunity? A whole different world, all different lifestyle. This is what David HaMelech wrote, King David. Even the Goim worship him, right? David, Daoud, Duvid, Nahon, David, same guy with many different names, different pronunciation. What does it say? Sas anochi al imratecha kemotze shalal rav. I'm so happy when I hear words of your Torah. It's like finding a treasure. And it's in the Tanakh, meaning Hashem proved that that's how he felt. Imagine how lucky we will be if we come out of the shul and we find a bag on the floor somewhere and we open it up. Hundreds of diamonds, blue, yellow, pink, rubies, $1 billion in a bag. And Baruch Hashem, no sign, no nothing, in the middle of nowhere. In the area when there's no Jews, Hashem Yirachem, where Sodom and Gomorrah, you found a bag like that. Imagine the happiness. Until now you suffer, everything struggle. Like now, I'll teach my boss a lesson. 20 years I suffer with him. The next day he comes, buy the business, make him a slave. Now you're going to follow my order. Just for that. All night he didn't sleep. Imagine he comes the next day, his boss said, did you clean the bathroom? No, today you're cleaning the bathroom. What do you mean? You want to get fired, I see. No, one more word, I'm going to fire you. Who do you think you are? I just bought this building, $500 million. I'm your boss. Run quickly, clean the bathroom. Just for that, he would run on the street dancing all night. Right or wrong? If David HaMelech said, when I hear Torah, it's like finding this bag with the diamonds. Imagine the feeling. Did you ever feel this? In all these years, you're listening to lectures and reading books and learning Gemara. Did you ever feel what he felt? The answer is no. Allow me to answer for you. So if the answer is no, where is the problem? The Torah is the same Torah, right? The same Torah that David learned is the same Torah, Baruch Hashem. So where is the problem? If the Torah said that when you learn, you should be happy just like that, and a person that learns is not happy like that, that means there is a hole in the bucket. Find the hole. Immediately, ASAP. Something is not right here. Someone that has no confidence in Hashem, every minute of his life is suffering. Every minute of his life. Stress, anger, cigarettes, drugs, all kinds of anti-depression pills, addictions, violence, dirty mouths, stealing, fighting. Horrible life. All of that is for what? Because he's worried about what's going to be. He has $50 million cash. And he still steals from people and sue them and fight them and go crazy and work until 10 p.m. Doesn't see his children. By the time he realizes, his children will not be able to look at him anymore. Even if they live fancy lifestyle and he helped them to buy houses and he put them in business. The one thing the children will remember is not that my father did everything for me. That my father was never around and never cared about me. That's all they're going to remember. You know what? I have news for you. I have a friend. He's the son of one of the biggest and holiest rabbi of the last generation in the world. Very famous. I don't want to say the name. He's his son. And he said to me, don't think that with all the admiration that I have to my father and the whole world admires him, don't think that I forgave him. I didn't think I... Listen carefully. I said, what? What do you mean? I never had a father, he said. My father was the father of the nation of Israel, not mine. He never had time for me. It was always yeshiva and always people and always meeting and after and he comes home and phone calls. And we did not grow up, me and my brother, with their father. But your father did this for you and he did that for you and you get from his books, he make millions of dollars from the royalty of his books, it all comes to you. You benefit a lot from your father. He put you in the best yeshivot. He helped you financially. None of that is remembered. There's one thing he remembered, that his father didn't have time for him. And even if he knows that his father is not that his father was sitting in a casino drinking beer every night, right? That's not what he's complaining about. He knows that his father gave his life for the Jewish nation, and he still feels in his heart frustration, I don't know how, or the right word, upset, that he did not have a father. Needless to say about people that today leave their children and they do horrible sins and they don't show up and they cheat and they go away and who knows what. They just workaholic. When a person gets suffering and sicknesses, also should say, thank you, God, I know it should have been a lot worse. I'm in your hand, not in the hands of the doctors. Odecha Hashem ki anafta bi. I'm thanking you, God, that you punished me. For that, you also have to say thank you. Yashov abchaot nachameni. And the same thing, you punish me today, I'm confident that when your anger will go away, you will cure me. Same sentence. I thank you for punching me, I thanking you for putting ice on my wound. Why? It's contradiction. I deserve the punch. And putting the ice on my wound and taking care of me, it's 100% kindness. Don't owe me that. I don't deserve it. This is what we say every morning in a tefillah. Baruch gozer umkayem. Baruch, bless him, God, that make the decree and give us the ability to handle it. Yes. How many times in your life something happened a day before the tragedy came? And if that something would happen, you'd be destroyed. That's it. And that's what actually what saved you. You never know in your life. You never know in your life where your salvation can come from. You never know. So, financial damage, thank you, God. Money loss, thank you. People stole from you, thank you. Thank you, it's this and not chas v'shalom cancer. Thank you, it's this and not death. Thank you, it's that and not my kid became a secular atheist. No matter when you think you got the biggest punishment, believe me, there are much worse punishments than that. When you see the wicked people celebrate and successful, should you be happy or upset? Very happy. Why? Two reasons. Who can give me the two reasons? So one is what's written in the end of Parashat Va'etchanan, the last three verses. They're getting their reward here, and soon they will get what they deserve. They're going to get their punishment soon. But there is a bigger reason for it. Bigger and maybe even better. What is it? Listen carefully. שיראה שמחת הרשעים ישמח ותענוגי הפושעים ויחשוב אם לא עוברי עבירה רצונו, אם לא עוברי רצונו כך, לאוסור רצונו על אחת כמה וכמה. Translation. When you see מחלל שבת enjoying life. Nice house, nice wife, children. Everyone healthy, money, nice car, good job, you know, dress well, eats well. You should be very happy. Why? If wicked people that hates God and write against him in the internet and curse the religious rabbis and curse the Torah and speak against everything that is holy, if they enjoy so much, when they don't deserve anything, imagine righteous people how much they're going to get. If the filthiest people on earth get so much pleasure, people that listen to God, needless to say, it's just a matter of time. Everyone with his turn. The Roman that was killing Rabbi Akiva, cutting his skin, old man, 120 years old, Rabbi is cutting him to pieces. He said to him, where is your God? Why doesn't save you such a holy rabbi? So he said to him, if a wicked person like you, right? If to someone like me that all my life listen to God and follow his instruction, that's my end, imagine what's going to be your end when he starts taking care of you. If I did everything perfect, maybe once or twice I made a sin, maybe in my whole life, a little tiny one, and this is my end for the once or twice that I did something wrong, if I ever did. So for the once or twice I did something wrong, this is what I'm paying for. Someone like you that all your life is rebelling against God, can you imagine when he will start with you, what's going to happen to you? The Romans got the shock of his life. You understand? So, don't ever be happy that your friend is failing in religion. He didn't succeed in yeshiva. He wasn't accepted to a good yeshiva. All kinds of things like this. Competition, yes. I want to be better than him. No problem. I want to be more righteous than him. No problem. I want to know more Torah than him. No problem. I want to give more tzedakah than him. No problem. It's all legit. This is very positive competition. But clean, fair fight. You don't put him in a negative position. You don't put him down to bring yourself up. And when he fails, you have to be upset, not happy. You want him to succeed. You want yourself to succeed more. No problem. I'm very happy that he got accepted to the yeshiva. I'm happy, but I'm also happy for him. I'm very happy he gave money to a good cause. I'm happy I gave even more. It's no problem. If he fail, you shouldn't be happy. Why are you happy? You're happy when your friend is failing? It makes Hashem upset. Why are you happy? Some people, their children went off the derech. They stopped being religious. It breaks their heart. When they see how they are, that's really a very bad feeling. Then they hear another family in the neighborhood, one of their kids also went, became like that. So they feel good. Why are you feeling good, you fool? You should feel double worse. If for your son you fail X amount, now you should feel double. Another child of Hashem got destroyed. Why are you happy? Because the way of the people are, if you lose in the stock market and everyone made money, it destroys you. But if all your friends lost, not such big deal. It comforts you. Why are you happy? Why does it help you if other people lost also? You're still in a bad situation, no? Should be upset for them as well. But that's the way the people are. When everybody else fail, I don't feel so bad. When they succeeded, then I feel very bad. Why? You see, that's all about ego and pride. Now we have Baruch Hashem. We finish with Simcha, with happiness. It was a little bit longer than 10 minutes. But we still have some time still speaking about De'aga. You know what De'aga means? Worry. When a person is worried, what do you call it? There's a name for it in English? Someone who worries all the time. Paranoid? Paranoia, it's fear more. It's more fear. I'm talking about worry. Worry, what's going to be, what's going to be, what's going to be. Neurotic? Tov. Adeaga, worry, it's very bad. Most of the time. We'll see when it's allowed, okay? You can make no mistake. By looking at a person's face, you know if he's worried about something or not. You don't have to be a rabbi to know. Everyone. What happened with you, Moshe, today? You're not the usual happy guy with the jokes and the smile. Very concerned. Right? You can see right away. What happened to you? My son having a road test now. I need him to pass. Wow, I cannot wait another month. I need him in a walk. He's very nervous. He's worried. Worry. When the phone comes, go, you answer the phone. I can't take it. They worry. People worry, what's going to be? This is what it's written in Bereshit Mem, verse 6. Vayar otam v'inam zo'afim. When you see on the face of a person that is angry, that is worried, that is upset, you see right away. And it's also written in Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 2, Madu panecha ra'im ve'ata incha chole. Why your face looks bad and you're not even sick? What do we learn from this verse? So when a person is sick, it changed the image of his face. We all know it. Here it's saying, why your face changed to the negative when you're not sick? Meaning there are other things who makes a person's face change to the negative. What is it? Worry, concern, fear. All those things. הדאגה לעולם הזה להשיג מאומה היא מגונה מאוד. Worry about collecting wealth is very despicable. Most people, 99% of the things they worry about is financial. They're afraid to spend. They worry if they get paid. When they deposit a check, for 3 days they don't sleep until they make sure the check cleared. All the time they live with such pressure until they get a heart attack when they're 49 years old. With good health, athletes, no cigarettes, no cholesterol, no fat, none of these things. What happened? The stress. Stress. Millionaires have more stress than poor people. Because their stress is in millions. Poor people, their stress is in $5, $10. Someone sent me today a check for how much?
$5.
How did you know? Huh? I was thinking to myself, is that a mistake or not? Because the stamp is 10%. The fee, just the stamp, is like paying PayPal 10%. Right? How much is a stamp today? Huh? 60 cents? Well, that's more than 10%. Here, come. Look at the check. Confirm. They don't believe me. If you're not going to confirm, they won't believe me. How much? Don't say the name. Just say how much the amount. $5. You see? Here you go. So that means the poor people, their concern and their activities isn't $5, $10. That's the poor people. What can they do? Usually. The rich people, it's in millions. On a deal, someone cheated him, $3 million. It's more than this poor guy makes in his entire 80 years of life. He's upset. The next day, he's back to normal. It's all in millions. You know, that's how it is. Sometimes you look at the stock market, a stock is $55.76. It went down to $55.75. For the poor people that they own 10 stocks, no, so they lost 10 cents. The tycoons, that cent is $1 million. That cent. Do you know in dollars, the dollar went down in Israel from 4 shekel to 3.5 shekel. It means that someone in America that had $100 million, there's a lot of Jews that have much more than that here, the $100 million used to be 400 million shekel. It went down to 350 million shekel. 50 million shekel, meaning 20 houses in Tel Aviv. They just lost because the currency went down. 20 nice houses in Tel Aviv. Or 50 houses in Be'er Sheva or Yerucham. Just for the currency change. Do you understand? Why the rich people, sometimes you look at them and they look 90 years old. Well, Moshe, only 50. What happened? Business is killing me. The stress. Unbelievable. Adaga is meguna meod. Just put your heart and your life in the hand of God. Take away. Get rid of all the worry. People that have confidence in Hashem don't have fear. And they are not worried. And they don't have the agony. And it does not destroy their heart and make them sick. When was this written? Over 800 years ago. Without Harvard degree. No? They didn't learn psychology in the best universities in America. Or medicine. He wrote to you, stress destroys the heart. Destroys the health of a person. הדואג על העולם הזה הוא רחוק מאוד מן התורה והמצוות והתפילה. If you worry about materialistic things, you cannot be in good level when learning Torah, performing commandments and praying. None of that will be good. Your prayers is not prayers, your learning is not learning, and committing and practicing the mitzvot is not the right way. Because the fear and the worry takes away your attention, your mood, your excitement, takes it away. Without it, it's worthless. In learning, you sit an hour in a lecture, half an hour you were just thinking about tomorrow's meeting. And the mortgage, and the default, and the problem, and the check that bounced. When can I, you're waiting for 9 o'clock tomorrow to call the guy. So now you have to learn now, at night, your mind is tomorrow in the office. You don't understand that before, already in Rosh Hashanah, that Hashem wrote a number. It's already known. You don't know it yet. But it's already a done deal. This check and all this is nothing. You're just discovering what Hashem decided 10 months ago. In Rosh Hashanah. He's just discovering it now. But it was already a reality 10 months ago. It was written in a book, in your book. this year, that's what you're going to make. So you're nervous, because until next Rosh Hashanah, by then you will know how much Hashem wanted you to make. In the last day of the year, you can make $1 million. Even though the year looks very bad, you're in real estate. You did not close one deal the entire year. Erev Rosh Hashanah, when everyone runs to the mikveh, and they do atarat nedarim, and this, you just finally got the call from the lawyer. Mazal tov. Finally, the customer signed the papers and gave the deposit. How much? $1 million deal. I have a friend. We were best buddies in the time of Manhattan. He was a real estate broker. No, agent. Not broker, agent. Renting apartments in Manhattan. There used to be different days in Manhattan. I'm talking to you 22, 23 years ago. Well, it was very, very cheap, the prices of the apartment. You can get a nice one bedroom in Upper East Side for $1,250. Now it's $4,000 or $5,000. Four or five times more now. In Harlem, you can get a beautiful big apartment, maybe not beautiful, but big, for $500. Today you're going to pay $5,000 for it. So you get the point, no? You could buy apartments in Manhattan back then for under $100,000 apartment. Today I don't think there's one apartment in Manhattan less than $600,000-$700,000. There's no such thing, I think. Maybe a bathroom you can buy for that, yes. So this friend of mine was working for a few years like a dog. He has no emuna. And he was like a slave, walking nonstop. 8 p.m. he's still in the office. 9, 10 sometimes. Early in the morning, 7 o'clock, he rushed to the office, running, showing apartments to customers before they go to work. You had to see how he worked. 7, 8 years he was working. Nothing. We used to come to his apartment, me and him. We used to go to places. After that, we used to go to, he lived in 888 8th Avenue. Not that I have good memory, but you cannot forget such a number. 888 8th Avenue. It's a building over there. Still there. He lived over there. That was, he was renting an apartment. He used to be a doorman, Puerto Rican, named Sammy. I wonder if he's still there. Short guy, Puerto Rican. The American people that live there, they are very cold to him. When we used to come to the building, two Israelis, all the other people, when he was very formal with them. Just give them the mail or the key or whatever. When we used to come, como esta, this, that, like buddies. This friendly lifestyles that we had, that we were friendly guys, me and him, brought him over $100 million today. How? One day, he was still running like a slave. Maybe he's going to rent another apartment for $1,000 commission. He got a call from Sammy. Sammy called him. Come quickly. What? The owner of the building wants to sell the building. $40 million only. It's worth $500 million today or more. $40 million was the price. He said to him, come quickly. I spoke to the owner. I told him there's a great guy in real estate over here, sharp Israeli. He agreed to give you the listing. Come quick. He got in a cab. He went quickly. The owner came. He gave him the contract. He found a Persian or something, or Israeli guys, I don't know, that bought the buildings. He made over $2 million commission. It was like $10 million today, 22 years ago. It's points. Over $2 million. Opened an office, became one of the strongest real estate offices in Manhattan. For what? Hashem wants you to make in a minute, you make what you didn't make in 50 years of slavery. That's what people don't get. The call from Sammy the Puerto Rican. Come quickly before he changes his mind. He left everything with a cab. Two miracles happen here. One is that Sammy thought about him because we were always friendly to him. And the second thing, that he found a buyer that bought the place. And the condition was that they let him live for free in that apartment. That's the condition of the deal. So it's another probably few millions since then until now. The rent of that place multiplied by 20-something years. Fantastic. You understand? You have nothing to worry about it. All you have to do is speak to your creator. Help me. I'm in trouble. I need money. Find me the right solution. That's all. And the miracles begin. Ma'itonen Adam Chai. What are you complaining about? You're still alive. Gever al Chataav. What are you complaining? You're full of sins and you're complaining? You're still alive. It's a miracle as it is. Nobody owes you anything. If you have to worry about something, worry about the sins you do against God. That's what you should worry about, nothing else. You understand? The tears that come from the agony and the worry are not positive. Hashem doesn't like this kind of tears. Which tears Hashem does love? Sha'are dima lo ninalu. The gate of tears never got locked. They're always open. When? Palgemaim yardu enai al lo shamru toratecha. David HaMelech wrote in Tehilim, Psalms 119, verse 136. Rivers of tears are falling from my eyes. Why? Because there are Jews that don't keep the laws of the Torah. That's very good crying. Why are you crying, Moshe? I see all these Jewish girls in a club here, how they dress, how they make scenes with all the monsters here, without going into details. It breaks my heart. I see 500,000 Israeli kids don't even know what Shulchan Aruch means, don't know what Shabbat means. Nothing is Jewish about them. Nothing. Not even one tiny thing. Many of them didn't have a bar mitzvah. I look at the Reform Jews in America, how they all became goyim. Not one of them survived as a Jew. 7, 8 generations, they all became intermarried, and you don't even know if one of them is Jewish, bichlal. No way to prove. They destroyed Judaism in the United States, and now they want to destroy Judaism in Israel. They fight, they want to steal the Western Wall, they want to force the Israeli government to recognize the conversion. How can you recognize a conversion that is made by a non-Jew? You tell me. Huh? You know what it's like? You have a doctor and you have a murderer. Everybody understand. The doctor saves life. The murderer takes life, right? Imagine the murderer's appeal to the government of the United States to give him a diploma, a certificate that he is the greatest life-saving. And the government say, let's open a negotiation. That's basically what's happening now with the reform movements and the Israeli government. Why the reform women fight to come with the yarmulke and tefillin to the Western Wall and they steal the Sefer Torah from the religious side? And why? They don't keep one mitzvah of the Torah. They don't marry Jews. They don't keep nothing. They eat pork on Yom Kippur. They do whatever they want. They don't keep anything. Why it's so important for them to make all this provocative things? That's mitzvah, only to get everyone angry. They don't care. They don't believe in the temple. Ask any Reform Jew if he believed there was a temple there. They don't even believe in it. They don't believe in God. Their rabbi said there was no exodus of Egypt. They married animals. They married to dogs. They make bar mitzvah to dog. They make a joke. They put tefillin on his head. Now they care about the Western Wall. The Arabs care about the Western Wall more than the Reform people. For real. Ask Muhammad, why you want to die here and kill Jews? It's a holy place. But it's not holy for you. It's holy for the Jews. Doesn't matter. I want it. Why you want Me'arat HaMachpelah, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Jacob is the father of the Jews. It has nothing to do with you, Arab. Why you want to steal it from the Jews? It's a holy place. I don't care. Mine, not mine. I'm going to lie to the whole world and say it's mine. It's Palestinian. It's not Jewish. Why? It's holy. It's precious. I will take it whether it's mine or not. Just like a person see a nice phone, $1,000 phone. It's not his. He steals it. Why are you stealing it? It's not yours. It's my personal phone. No, it's not yours. It was always mine. It wasn't yours. It's mine. No, it's mine. And all the people in the restaurant, he's right. It's his. That's basically what's happening now between Israel and the world. That's what's happening. But the reform doesn't even want it. You're asking, I don't even want it. I don't believe in a temple. I don't believe in slaughtering and sacrificing. He doesn't believe in God. But he wants to come and disturb everyone. Why? Women, miniskirt, put filling on their hair. Just to get everyone upset. That's what's going on here. So when are you allowed to be worried? When you see that people got to such a low level, you're allowed to cry. When you see you making sins, you failing again and again, you're allowed to cry. Mitzvah to cry. Ki avoni agid, edag michatati. I'm revealing my sins. I'm worried about them. It's a verse. Mitzvah to be worried about my sins. Don't be like the fools. Think positive, it will be positive. No, you fool. If you think positive about your sins, it will be 10 times worse than negative. Not just negative, 10 times worse for your chutzpah. You're breaking Shabbat and you think positive, you think it's going to go away? All your death penalties, where did this dream come from? You're going to murder people and think that Hashem will let it go? Think positive. It's okay. Don't worry. Nonsense. You shouldn't think positive. You should be worried about your sins unless you made a full repentance. That's a different story. Always check. Why are you so worried, Moshe? Why are you crying? You became a big rabbi. You have so much zchuyot. Why are you crying like this? You're making me nervous. If you cry like this, I have to cry 10 times more than you. Or 1,000 times more than you. Why are you crying? You're a holy man. What holy? I didn't even start my tshuva. If you think you're perfect, you will never cry. You will never apologize. People that think they're perfect, they never apologize. You realize it, right? If people know they're wrong, they apologize. Really know. Not sometimes for the manners, they apologize because they don't want to fight. It's not good for the reputation. When they really realize they did something wrong, they really apologize. You see, it's sincere. Ashrei Adam mefached tamid. Mitzvah always to fear God. Always. Why are you fearing? I fear my lashon hara. I fear not watching my eyes. I fear not being 100% careful with what I eat. I fear very much the way on Shabbat. Maybe I don't learn enough. Maybe I sleep too much. Maybe I pray too late. There could be a lot of things. Even in the small things you pay attention. That shows that you have Yirat Shamayim. Maybe I don't give enough tzedakah. I had a very good year. I gave $1 million tzedakah. But I made 10. I just realized maybe Hashem wanted me to give 6, 7. Why did he give me 10 million? I don't need 10 million. For 200,000 I leave. Why he gave me 10 million? 9 million I saved after all the tzedakah. Is that really, maybe I did something wrong? Maybe I could have saved another 5,000 Jews and make them Shomrei Shabbat with this money. Of course, that's how you have to think. I know what you're thinking. If that's how we're going to think, Rabbi, we won't have a minute of rest. Very good. You shouldn't. When it comes to spirituality, you didn't come to rest. You worry about money. You worry about fame. You worry about vacation. You worry about pleasure. You worry about cars. You worry about a lot of nonsense. About your team, they win the championship, they won't win. A lot of stupid things. And the only thing you should worry about, almost nobody worry about. Rabbi, don't be so fanatic. How they said, have a word. Chill out. Chill out. I love this rabbi. He's chilled. Chill. Why? Telling jokes, telling stories, a little bit about Hollywood. Right? Even if now he's 100% righteous and clean, he should fear. Maybe I will sin eventually. Maybe now he's in a very good condition. He said for 10 years he did not get out of yeshiva, learning nonstop. No, how many sins he could have done? Nothing. learning, gives his life for the Torah, no? But he's thinking, now I'm going to get married. Maybe I have to move to a different place, in different neighborhood. Who knows? Maybe I'll sin over there. We found in Yaakov Avinu, Jacob, Hashem told him, I'm going to keep you in anywhere you go. I will protect you. He was worried, maybe I'll make a sin and I lose God's blessing. Right away, he said to God, if you give me and you protect me on my way, I'll give you 10% from everything you give me. Charity, not to you, to people, as you ordered. And David HaMelech wrote in Psalms 27, verse 13, Lule e'emanti lirot betuv Hashem be'eretz chaim. If I did not believe to see the greatness of God in a life of eternity, all the things that I do, it's thanks to one fact, that I know that soon I'm going to come to a place which is life of eternity, and I will finally see the ultimate greatness of God. Eretz HaChaim. On the graves of the Jewish people, when they die, they put few letters. Taf, period. Nun, period. Tzadik, period. Bet, period. Hey, period. Tan Tzavaha. Five letters. What is it? Abbreviation. Te Nishmato Tzrura Betzror HaChaim. His soul will be attached to the group of souls that in the land of life of eternity. The camera is dying. You know what? Is it still recording? Yeah? Still recording? Okay. Maybe I'll finish. I have another page and two or three more minutes. So, when you finally follow the right path in religion, check. Maybe I'm not keeping it 100%. Maybe it can be better. Maybe I can pray better. Maybe I can pray earlier. Maybe I can do more. Maybe I can learn more. Maybe I can learn in a higher level. One of the ways to succeed in life is to listen to speakers or teachers that shake your heart all the time. Speakers who put you in a numb position. Great, great feeling. Nice, interesting shiur, lecture. But don't make you shake and fear, wow. According to what I just heard, I have a long way to go. I better wake up fast. If by listening to them again and again and again, and you're not making any progress, they're not making you fear, they're not making you worry about your spirituality, they're not motivate you, they don't inspire you, no matter how great they are in Torah, and they could be very holy people, that's not the medicine for your sickness. You can only listen and connect to someone who wakes you up and motivates you and push you to go higher and higher in Avodat Hashem. Without going into names, everyone with his style, some people, this is what motivates them, some people that. Like in medicine, the doctor prescribes medicine to different people according to age and male, female, you know, according to their needs. You know that, not the same medicine for everyone. For children, they have different dose. So, don't look for jokes and stories only. What about waking up? 20 years you're going and learning every day and still quarter yarmulke and still dress like a goy and still speak like a goy and still admire the university with the right and ideology and still vote for Democrats? How can it be? 20 years you're going to learn Torah and you still vote Democrats? Gay parade, all kinds of horrible crimes against God, and you're voting for them? How can it be? Something is not right here. No one motivated you. If you listen to Rabbi Avigdor Miller, you wouldn't do it. You couldn't listen to him and stay the same. You couldn't. There are other great speakers who know a lot of Torah, but they wouldn't motivate you. They would not. with all due respect to them, can read a book just to gain knowledge, no problem. You can even listen to them just to gain knowledge, no problem. But you must have someone who shake your heart, make you cry in a lecture. People cry. People worry not to be involved in machloket. I don't want to be in a fight, in a battle. I don't want to fight, I don't want to take a side. People fighting, don't be like Korach. Run away. What do you think? I have no opinion. I don't want to have a part in it. In machloket, children die. Innocent children die. Everybody dies. The people, the children, their property, everything. That's how much God hates fights and disagreements and all these things that people do. Someone died in his family. You're allowed to cry. It's natural. It's not a sin. Cry. Cry for him. Cry for yourself. Cry for your lost. Yes. But the way you should cry for is, I hope that he did not die with open sins. His father died. Oh my God. Why are you crying so much? I'm worried about my father's soul. Maybe he didn't do full tshuva. Not because I lost him and life's going to be boring now. No. Maybe he did not complete his tshuva. Maybe he didn't learn enough Torah. Maybe I'm not going to be able to do enough for his soul. Beg the Creator. If a very special, holy, righteous person die, cry nonstop. It's a loss for the entire nation and for the world. And Hashem is crying very much for that. It's a loss for his nation. Sometimes a person like this died to save the death of thousands of others. That's because it goes by quality, not quantity. And the Satan was pushing for tragedy. And Hashem took one or two righteous or kids instead of killing thousands of wicked people. Maybe extending their time, maybe they do repentance. We found that Achan Ma'al Bacherem, one guy in the time of Joshua, he took from the property of the Goyim when Hashem said no one will touch their property after they died. Nobody touch it. It's all belong to the idols, idol worshipping. No one should touch it. And one Jew stole. Thousands died for an act of one Jew. Everyone is one unit. Because of him, thousands dies, thousands of people. We found Eliyahu Hanavi did not speak to Yehoshua ben Levi, Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi. Why? Because one lion ate a Jew in his area. One Jew was walking in a place, there was a lion, and he killed a Jew. He ate him up. He was few miles away from his house. He blamed Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi that the Jew died in his property. Why? If you were doing a little more, the Jew would not get hurt. Your merit will protect him. You didn't pray enough. Maybe if you would do a little more, it would not happen. Eliyahu Hanavi didn't come to him. Why? He's blaming him. What is it my fault? I'm not the sheriff of the world. Yes, you are. When you're a big rabbi, you are. Many thousands of people can get saved thanks to you. Chas v'shalom, the other way around. 3 years there was hunger in the time of King David. He looked for what's the reason why Hashem is punishing us 3 years with hunger, starvation. In the end, he found that because of him, it happens. I'm guilty. He blamed himself in the end. If your life is too comfortable, worry. Most likely you're getting paid for your mitzvot in this world and you have no next world. Worry very much. If you are a big rabbi or a great speaker or someone that follow the truth and teach the truth and people abuse you for that. They insult you, they fight you, they make lies about you, they write against you on the internet, they write in the newspaper against you, they constantly speak against you every time you say something that is true. You should be very, very happy and multiply your reward by millions. If you die for the truth, even greater. Some people die for the truth. They actually kill them for saying the truth. Like Prophet Isaiah, his grandson Menashe, cut him to pieces, killed him for saying the truth. Very big level, very high level. When the honor of Hashem is being destroyed and people step over it, you have to feel a broken heart for it. Look what people do to the Torah. Look what they teach. Look how they destroy Judaism. For that you have to cry very much and fight very much to protect the truth. You have to cry for the level of the scholars that keep going lower and lower. The level of each generation is lower than the one before. And you have to fear and to cry that people that follow Hashem and fear God, they are hated by the public. They don't like the ultra-Orthodox. They call them names, fanatic, crazy, extremist. They have names for them. For that you have to cry that people became such low-life that instead of kissing their feet, they're making names to them and putting them down. I will finish with a story. Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal was learning Torah. And one guy broke into his room. Rabbi, a Jewish kid, just got hit by a car, died right there on the spot. Right there, on Lower East Side. The rabbi told him, it cannot be a Jew. Go and check, you see it's not a Jew. He said to him, Rabbi, I was there, I saw the yarmulke next to the body on the floor. Well, a goy doesn't wear yarmulke, a goy kid. It was on the floor next to the head. Rav Moshe Feinstein said, go and check, do me a favor. Cannot be a Jew, go. Okay. He went downstairs. 5 minutes later, he came back in shock. Rabbi, you were right. It wasn't the Jew. What happened is a non-Jewish kid was running after a Jewish kid to hit him. The Jewish kid made it, but while he was running, his yarmulke fell on the floor, and a car came and hit the non-Jewish kid that wanted to hit him, to beat him up. So the non-Jewish boy was dead, not the Jewish boy. But how did you know? So he said, it cannot be that under my terrace, under my room, when I gave all my life to God and learning non-stop Torah and doing good things to people, that one of my own family, a Jewish family, will die under my own terrace in my neighborhood. It cannot be. In a different city, yes. But right here, under where I gave my whole life for God, in my neighborhood, when it's my responsibility spiritually, I know it cannot be. You understand the idea here? Based on what I just told you. Eliyahu HaNavi did not speak to Rabbi Yoshua ben Levi. Why? Because a lion killed a Jew in his area. 3 parsarot from his place. Meaning, if you were a little bit more righteous, it wouldn't happen. And we saw that Hashem said to Avraham Avinu, if we will find 10 righteous people in Sodom, was worse than San Francisco, I will leave all the wicked people alive for the 10 righteous ones. Millions. I won't touch them. You see, the merit of the righteous people save the wicked. And what thank you the wicked give them? Spit in their face and beat them up. That's what the Chazal say. Alma de Shikra, the world of lies. We'll see you next Monday. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen.